Welcome to the Salt Circle Podcast. My name is Hank. With me today is Ben.
We're doubling down, baby.
Yeah.
It's happening.
We were this close to doing a movie commentary.
So close.
It was. There were no technical issues. There were some minor technical issues, but we actually cleared those up.
It was all
set. But what if we just yelled about magic, though?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. It's not our fault that a lot of magic-related things happened between the last episode and this one. Who are we to hold off the content, you know?
We are but the arbiters.
I already cracked the beer, though, so that's hot. The beer is hot.
Yeah. That'll be the title of the episode. Ben cracked a beer. So magic, though.
Yeah, man.
What do you want to talk about? What do you want to talk about first?
There's a lot to unpack. So, let's see if we can think of what. So, there's obviously the new cards. How do you pronounce the set name, by the way?
Eldraine.
Throat. So we have not only our first spoilers, but I think this was a surprise to everyone, right? The Brawl event in Arena. I don't think that was like teased, was it? It was a surprise to me.
Yeah, they might have said something, but I was definitely surprised.
Yeah. My time zone is all fucked up, so suddenly it was there at 8 p.m.
Suddenly you can play Brawl. They were like, you can play Brawl in Arena right now. And I'm like, oh. And then it's like, and it's pre-cons. And it's the Brawl pre-cons. I'm like, oh.
Yeah, it's pretty good. It's pretty good. So that's a thing. Yeah. I think the other thing is still historic, maybe. I forget what we talked about on the last episode, but there's probably some more stuff there to unpack a little. I think those are the two big ones. I mean, the huge one is Eldraine and the Brawl event.
I thought you were going to say the huge one is Theros.
I mean, that's like the massive one that everybody should just know, regardless of whether or not they play Magic. Like, I should be able to walk down the street in Russia and be like, Zdrasti. And they'll be like, did you hear Theros is coming?
I mean, I've had strong suspicions Theros was coming, but now we have.
I mean, the temple reprints. Actually, the biggest one is the little enchantment boy. That they cost one less, and he has like blatant Theros artwork on his card. Like, come on.
Well, there's also all the stuff in Throne of Eldraine that's like artifacts or enchantments.
Mm-hmm.
They're building it in so that those cards work with both things.
Yeah.
No matter whatever you're feeling, or in case all the artifacts in this. In Standard or bad, like they have been.
I mean, okay, so for me, that's a good transition to the Brawl event. The first deck that I tried out was the Knight deck.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's trash, but the fact that there was a way to use the Colossal Hammer is amazing.
Yeah,
being able to. Yeah. Equip that shit for zero felt good.
I mean, there's a modern deck built around that.
Really? Is it viable?
It's been doing stuff. Definitely 5-0'd an MTGO League. Which is like the test for if this deck playable.
Yeah. Mostly. Okay.
I don't know, people have also been messing with it in. Yeah. People have been messing with it. Saffron Olive did a video on it at some point and played it on Modern Super League.
Gotcha. So
it's
not
like top tier, but it's a thing.
For Brawl, what was your you said that you gravitated towards Bant, if I remember right?
Yeah.
And that is let me see if I remember all of it right. It's a little 5-drop Bant boy.
I think
is it 2/4?
They're all he's five a little, drops.
Night guy is 6. Night boy is 6.
Is he?
Yeah. Because it was real annoying having to get to 6 to cast him each game.
Fair enough.
Yeah, and the Bant guy is whenever you cast a creature, you may put a land card onto the battlefield from your hand.
Well, first you draw a card.
You draw a card, right?
Then
you may put. I was thinking that was it, but when I read him
like,
earlier, I must have missed that because I was like double checking and okay, yeah.
It's like the Thrasios thing, except they did it in a less wordy way.
Yeah,
and it functionally is slightly different, but it's that thing of your. You're drawing a card and ramping if there's land, if what you're getting is land.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just, like, nuts. It's like, drawing a card is pretty good. You didn't need to make drawing a card better, but okay.
and then for I guess maybe mid or late game shenanigans, you can, what is it, pay 3 and tap him to return a creature? Or is it just pay 3?
Yes.
Pay 3 and tap?
You pay 3, you tap him, you return a creature you control to your owner's hand.
Yes. And then you can cast it and draw a card.
Yeah, man. It's really good with Spectral Sailor.
Yep.
It's 1 mana flash. Then you could just tap 4 and draw a card.
Yeah.
Ramp.
How would you say your win rate was? Like, were you doing well with him, or do you feel like you got crushed an equal amount of times? Struggle?
I lost sometimes when, like, if other decks had really good, fast starts, I would lose, but if I got to establish, I felt pretty good.
Yeah.
It didn't take too long to get there. But I wasn't unbeatable either, so.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely lost.
Yeah.
But I also did think I got to, like, cast Parhelion 2 a couple times.
Nice. I had that dropped on me.
Where I'm just... it's like, here. Here's... What is it? 13 power attacking you?
Yeah.
It's like, can you deal with that? The times it felt bad was like, I have all these high cost drops that don't impact the board and aren't that big.
Yeah.
And I kind of can't deal with stuff, which was kind of my problem with all the decks. Like, one of the reasons I liked that deck the best is just because it had friggin' Time Wipe in it. Like, it had an actual Wrath effect.
Yeah.
Which I feel like that's what I definitely won, were the games I had Time Wipe.
Yeah, I was... As I mentioned, I gravitated to the Knight deck first. I think, as far as themes
I mean, the
go,
Knight deck was spicy.
Yeah,
that was
I really
definitely,
like it.
I was like, what deck do I want to be good? The Knight deck.
Yes.
What deck do I actually think is good?
Yeah, no, 100%. Dude, the Knight deck just... I played a fair amount with it. Maybe at least 8 games, if not more. I think I won like once or twice. Every other deck can actually do things. Like, people hit turn 5, they generally cast their commander, and instantly started getting value. I hit turn 5, and I can't cast my commander, and... I have some big guys on the field, but, like, the Jund deck has the thing that whenever a creature enters, you can fight something. Okay, well, my shit's dead, because without my commander, I'm not putting my hammer on anything. It didn't have enough interaction. though. I ended up finishing off everything with the Jun deck, which was amazing. Like, that's the shit I like.
Yeah.
I think my highlight...
Night deck, it really bugs me that it has single combat instead of an actual board wipe.
Mm-hmm.
Because your one creature just isn't going to be as good as one of the other deck's one creature.
Yeah.
Your creatures just aren't generally not that good.
Yeah. No, the highlight of my whole experience with Brawl was when someone turned their golden egg into a 4/4. And it turns out that's a permanent effect. So they just fucking rolled over me with an egg for the whole game. And I lost. Like, I couldn't do shit.
Yeah.
Rough times.
Pretty good.
I couldn't even be mad at that one. So...
Yeah, fucking Thorn Mammoth. When somebody gets a Thorn Mammoth on you, it's kind of...
That's the fighty boy?
I don't know what to do. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's rough.
It's like, oh, whenever they play a creature, and when it comes into play... Oh, yeah. I'm just done.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, even, like, worst case scenario with it, maybe you hit two things and it dies because you did it on the same turn, but, like, like, it's probably worth it.
Yeah.
My only thing is that...
I mean, bacon to a pie is a...
Bacon to a pie is fucking amazing. Like, in terms of flavor, literally, yeah. And art. It's
And also,
delicious.
There's Taste of Death.
Taste of Death, like, is so good.
They're making good use of the food theme.
Yep. Oh, absolutely.
Food.
I should
bring back wood tokens.
People are just... I love how I think some of them are legitimately upset that, like, the wording on cards is sometimes like, create 2 food tokens, sacrifice 2 foods, and people just don't like it. Some people are real upset by it.
Yeah. They've done things with the wording in Magic to make it to shorten things and make it easier for digital formats that... So I'm reading some of these cards and it's weird. Like Golden Goose just feels weird.
What's the
way the words are?
How's that one worded?
I have to bring it up now. No.
I mean, please. Okay. Like...
Golden Goose MTG was giving me shoes. Garbage. So it's the thing of tap, sacrifice a food, : add 1 mana of any color. I don't know. There's just something. It's like not that bad.
Yeah.
I'm like overstating it. But.
Doesn't sit well.
Yeah. I don't know. I missed the mana pool. Add 1 mana of any color to your mana pool. The old wording.
So, I think my favorite thing so far... I'm checking to see if there's, like, anything else that I've missed that I would possibly like better. Oh, Frogify is a great fucking name.
Uh-huh.
By the way, Frogify, pretty good.
I'm excited to put that in my frog deck.
the land tournament grounds is really cool. I fucking love that as a land. For anyone not in the know, tournament grounds, it's a land. It taps for a colorless, or it taps for red, white, or black if you spend that mana to cast a knight or equipment spell. That shit is dope. I'm down for some nice tribal shit. which, like, clearly they're pushing, and who knows if it'll be good, but...
Yeah. You know, like, I am always down for uncommon lands that are actually good.
Mm-hmm.
Give them to me all the time. I'm also excited, like, for by Witch's Cottage. Just another, I'm always stoked when they make lands that are basic land types that are also do something.
Mm-hmm. People were saying, like...
Which is... I don't know. It is the weird thing of, like, it's just kind of... I guess, I don't know. It's, like, it's specifically for mono-black decks, so...
Yeah, what were... People were, I think, maybe, maybe it's not overhype. I guess if you're already doing, like, mono-black stuff, but... I think some people were maybe getting a little too deep into it, thinking that it was going to, like, warp decks using black. Like, I don't think that's the case.
No. Because also, putting something on top of your library is not that powerful. Like, that's way weaker than drawing a card.
I mean, it's even weaker.
Particularly when you're doing it. Particularly when you're not, like, end of turning it or something.
Yeah.
That you're doing it during your main phase. I don't know.
Or if you're me, and you would put it on top of your library, and then forget about it immediately, and then crack a fetch. Makes the card really bad.
Yeah, that's true. Oh, man, you just need that card in your deck somewhere. You don't need it right now, but you might need it later.
You just want it somewhere. Yeah, I'm, like, overall so far, I'm pretty fucking excited. It's alternate art, right? On, like, the, what are they calling them? The story cards or the storybook cards or something?
The storybook cards. I think that's, like, I don't remember what they're called.
The ones that have a book
vibe. But I know what you're talking about. You said storybook, and I immediately knew what cards you were talking about.
Yeah. That art is looking fucking great.
That frame is just...
The frame is looking really good.
Like, although, it does have the issue of, I look at that card, I don't actually know how that mechanic works.
It's a bit confusing, yeah. It's like...
Well, it's because you can cast the spell part and then cast the creature later.
Yeah.
It just, like, exiles it into a castable state.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just weird. And it doesn't... None of those cards that I've seen, like, make sense of that mechanic to me.
It does, like, not... It just feels... Yeah, in Arena, it's very... It doesn't... There's no... The indicators are not good enough. Like...
Well, it's also just, like, in terms of how the cards function, I don't understand. Like, I don't see the purpose of having these two sides...
I mean, you cast one, like, and like, you cast the other, right?
Compared to... Well, yeah, but what's... Like, I'm returning a creature from my graveyard to your hand, and then later I'm casting a 2/2 that flyer that can't block? Like...
Yes.
It's weird. Or I'm casting 7 mana for 3 bears, and then later I'm casting a 1/2?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think it's... I mean, it's just, like, extra value, right? I guess.
Yeah. Like, but there's no synergy in any of the cards I've seen so far. Which is... I get, like... And it's just trying to be flavor. It's not really trying to be mechanical synergy.
Yeah.
I guess.
Look, the important part is that we got alt art of Order of Midnight that has Seb McKinnon. So, justify.
I mean, Seb McKinnon out of 10. Pretty much. Buy those $20 booster packs and maybe get one of those. The collector's booster packs.
Fuck. Collector's nonsense.
Haven't you always wanted to pay $20 for one booster pack, though?
No.
Oh.
Generally. Please.
What if Magic cards were just... You could just spend more on them.
I mean, Arena killed Paper Magic for me, so... Like, unless it's a booster pack of art-sized cards, like
I wonder if they'll do collector's packs in Arena, where you get like it comes with theme, like the skins for them.
I mean, isn't that kind of what the skin packs already are when you classify them in that area?
Yeah, but you're just buying. You're not buying a random.
Okay. So you're saying like a true booster pack of maybe you'll get something pretty. Okay. Yeah. I got you.
Maybe you'll get a skin for a card you own.
They would get my money.
I don't think they're gonna do that.
No. No, there's no way.
I think they're just gonna be totally willing to sell you those skins, but
I am happy that they put the guild stuff back.
Yeah, they said that's like their plan is bringing some of that stuff back piecemeal, so that like when they first put it out, they'll bundle stuff, and then later they might bring parts of it back for people to get.
Yeah, and the fact that like
I'm thinking about if I'm gonna actually get one of those sleeves.
Yeah.
Now that they're not like
terribly expensive.
You don't have to buy all the others. They're still pretty expensive.
Yeah, but you don't get the useless shit. I want one. I just don't know which one. I like that
I think I'm leaning towards Is It.
Yeah.
But the other one I just really like is Boros, but I think Is It is more
pretty good.
The one I like the most when I'm really looking at it.
Boros, I mean,
is nice and clean, but
Selesnya, it's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, that's yes, that's the one that makes the most sense for you, I think.
Yes, yeah, in terms of shockingly what
you're into. It's a tree.
It's Ben a tree. Loves it. I mean, Gruul is also tempting though because it's a violent tree, sort of. Not really, like, symbol-wise, but, like, that's their shtick. I mean, they're a tree, yeah, but they're angry.
It's a skull.
Yeah. I don't know. I'll probably wait. What if there's something better added with Eldraine?
I mean, I already pre-ordered the Eldraine, so I actually have access to the gingerbread sleeve already.
Oh, fuck. Seriously?
So that kind of tampers... Yeah. So that kind of tampers... The need to have any other sleeve, right?
How much is $50 in rubles? I've already looked this up. Apparently, it auto-filled. Okay, that's not bad. I might do that up when payday comes around. Yeah, no, the gingerbread skin is real good.
It's just so dumb. It's unbelievably dumb.
I do like for the avatars, you can now pay gold. That feels good.
Wow. I didn't even know that was a thing.
Yeah.
I didn't see that.
And it's not bad. Like, 3,000 is not bad at all. That's like 3 days of play, generally.
Yeah. Yeah, that's not bad. Maybe I'll get one of those with ghouly golds.
Yeah. I don't even know who I'd get. Like, I want Vraska, but I want Pirate Vraska. I'm still kind of... That's something we could maybe...
You don't want Tristani?
I mean, I do want Tristani. Like, come on. Of course I want Tristani.
Aurelia?
Not Aurelia. Why would I want Aurelia?
I don't know.
Does she look
not
like
Aurelia?
Does she got branches? I don't see any branches there. Look at Tristani. Tristani is a branch.
Oh. Yeah, I don't know. None of these are Karn.
So that's true.
I like how the Vanifar one looks.
Vanifar.
I think that was the one I was.
Oh yeah, Vanifar is pretty good.
Tempted by. Yeah.
Kaya is real good. Kaya.
Yeah. That's not my favorite Kaya art.
But. No. Another big thing that happened is Garrick's back.
Yes. I mean, that was. That's another thing that was, like, clearly going to happen. Because they were, like, notable, like, yeah, he's not in War of the Spark because we're doing a thing with him.
Mm-hmm. Someone on Reddit had a really good prediction about it, though. Like, they, maybe not necessarily that it was, like, if it was obvious that he was in the set, but, like, they predicted the exact card number that he would be based on, like... We had all of, like, two spoilers, and one of them was whatever the main Planeswalker dude is, the shirtless guy. And he's like, well, based on what we know about how the cards are ordered, it has to be either this thing or this thing. And what are the odds that they make it this thing? And, like, I don't know, 12 other reasons that are mathematical, almost, and it's Garrick.
Yeah.
And now it is.
I mean, that makes sense. They're pretty... standard about like how many planeswalkers they have and
yeah, you
know, how they number their sets. Just reading, he was reading the patterns.
Mm-hmm.
Also, and the Garrick thing was just like, if you knew anything about Garrick,
yeah,
and Magic, you knew he was coming back. They were gonna do a thing. Did you watch the trailer? The cinematic.
I watched not all of it. I know, like, I saw the last thing I remember is, like, Garrick smashing through and, like, the little gingerbread couple hiding behind a pot.
Yeah, man.
I mean, I...
But you didn't...
Like, do they make
you didn't
it?
You didn't get to the best part.
That sounds so, right.
Again, like, they're running, then they run to the edge where there's, like, you know, a pot of boiling sauce or something, and then I don't remember. I think Garrick, that like a pot of milk smashes,
yeah,
and knocks them over the edge, and then they're hanging on for dear life. And the I think the dude, the like the girl, is caught on, and the dude's hanging, and then she like flings him up, so then he's standing up and trying to pull her up, and then Garrick smashes, like cuts off his hand, so she falls.
Oh my god!
And then he's all sad, and then Garrick eats the gingerbread man.
Oh,
and then it shows
yeah,
the gingerbread girl survived, and then she becomes very angry.
Oh my god!
And like the last
god
shot is her, like that's what the sleeve is based on, is her like
okay
with a utensil, and she like jumps at Garrick, and then it cuts.
Jesus.
She's fucking actually attacking him.
That's amazing. That's so good. New Planeswalker when?
I just love it because it's standard Magic being really silly in a way they just...
Dude,
they
hear me
they kind of stopped doing years ago.
What if we get a fucking Hot Soup reprint? So good. Still the best story in Magic.
Although, yeah, I guess it makes sense. I did hear that the Mark Rosewater's bosses, who are very anti-squirrel, are all gone. He has outlived all the... For whatever reason, people above him Magic were like, squirrels are too silly for standard Magic. But those people are all gone now.
And so the golden age begins.
And so the golden age begins. The possibility for elves in black border magic.
God bless.
Or, yeah, squirrels.
I mean, I know what you meant.
It's just weird that someone was like, no, squirrels can only be in silver bordered sets. They're too silly.
What?
I mean, they are kind
of partly, and that's also like why in like Onslaught all the squirrels are edgelord squirrels.
Yeah.
Squirrely like, boys.
Whatever. That squirrel behemoth has like threshold +7/+7.
Yeah.
Mean. They're angry squirrels. I don't know. The flavor of the set is just so fun because it's just very different.
Yeah.
Although their takes are pretty edgelord on all this stuff.
In what way?
Like,
seem fine to me.
Here's Goldilocks. She's a human with an axe.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's like, it's kind of fitting for me, though, I think. Like, because, you know, fairy tales have that weird thing where, like, they're cutesy and whimsical, but also they're, like, dark as fuck. Right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think it fits well.
Yeah. And, I mean, magic is about violence and war, so it makes sense to play up that stuff. I don't know. It's just like their version of Goldilocks is. It's like the quintessential for me. I don't know.
So I do have a question.
Yeah, sure.
There is a thing. It's in the main client, and it like popped up when I was playing earlier today. It said something about renewal rewards.
Yeah.
What's that about?
They said it in the state of the beta.
I didn't watch that.
It wasn't. I don't even know if it was in the video. It was in the article. Which I can't find now.
Classic.
I know we're getting like a bunch of. You get a bunch of cards. You get. Here it is. Okay. 10 rare cards, ICRs. Okay. And also, I think if you're renewing. Like, if you've been playing, you get Eldraine set mastery boost. Like, you get to start at level 25.
Okay.
Maybe. I don't... With renewal... Or you get more stuff, maybe? Maybe that's not it. Maybe just get more stuff.
That one sounds more correct.
Like, like you get... Without renewal rewards, or maybe they just give you like the first 25 levels of it without buying it or something. I don't know.
Because
you get like an extra 2 packs of Eldraine, 4 other packs, and then 4 uncommon ICRs, it looks like, is what you get out of the...
Gotcha.
On top of the 12 packs and the 2 mastery orbs for the thing standardly. And then also they're doing, in the lead up to it, they're doing events that are going to give you basically an XP dump. Like you get 200 XP for every 2 consecutive wins.
Yeah, the 2 consecutive wins.
Max out your mastery. So if you haven't maxed out your mastery pass, you can grind it out.
Just going to roll into play with my mono blue deck. Pray hard.
Yeah. I like that they have to they're just the reiterating of no collection resets, because technically, I actually get why they're doing that, because the last time they reset was when rotation happened. It was like their cheat.
Yeah.
For dealing with it was, with rotation comes all your stuff resets, which is no longer acceptable. Also, with Throne of Eldraine, though, technically Magic Arena is actually coming out.
Oh, is it the 1.0 release?
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
They're ending it as being a beta. Just kind of, I mean, it's both make sense to me, because, like, I mean, the game, a lot of people are playing it. It exists as it is. But also, like, they don't even have player drafting in yet.
I mean,
still a lot of stuff. I mean, like, they're not going to stop working on it. But
yeah, I mean, a friends list would be nice.
Yeah, they don't even have friends lists. They did the bare minimum for playing with friends, which is, I mean, good. Like, you can play with your friends. It's functional, but there's still a lot they could do that I kind of expected them to do before they would say it's released.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The thing I don't understand is, okay, I don't know, there's just this weird thing of, like, I know people on Reddit were very mad about there not being a historic ranked queue,
mm-hmm.
but they talk about there is a historic ranked queue. It's just not, they didn't guarantee it for as being around all the time at first.
Yeah.
Because they're like, we're doing historic ranked queue for 4 weeks. Like, a month of historic ranked,
mm-hmm.
or whatever.
Well, and you can still play it, like, regularly. Like, in the quick play.
Yeah. It's like, it's just that one of those things where it's like, clearly they don't want it to step on standard.
Which I don't think it would.
And in particular, I feel like the fact that they're technically have to launch it at the same time as Throne of Eldraine, I kind of get why they're holding off with stuff, to say, like, you want the focus of people to be on this new set and this new standard, and then once people have played that for a bit, then
yeah,
we're gonna beef up historic and get you to focus on that because you're tired of standard or whatever.
Hopefully.
It's like, because, like, for Wizards, that's, like, the appeal of the older formats, is for the hardcore players that want to be playing Magic all the time, but would get bored with Standard not changing off quite often enough for them. It's something else to do, but still playing Magic and being in that ecosystem.
Yeah. I mean, did you see the comment about, we want players to log in and think they're having fun. Our two-cost system is part of that. Like, that's a bad quote. That's like up there with sense of pride and accomplishment, I think. It's pretty gross. The double wild card thing. Like,
I mean, the way they're thinking about it is they're trying to incentivize new players from looking at that, from going to that stuff, like new players,
but I don't
push them towards standard.
I think there's like a natural gravitation to standard, though, isn't there, for new players?
I mean, not if you're looking, just like looking through the cards you could make and you're like, ooh, I like this card.
I guess,
like, if you don't, like, honest, I would say there's no push towards anything in particular for a new player necessarily. Like, a new player is not going to know what standard is necessary. It's like, oh, what are the cards in this game?
Mm-hmm.
I think they would actually just be lower information unless the game is pointing them in directions with signaling, such as these cards are cards you can build.
And I guess
standard.
I feel like there has to be
more expensive and only playing this other format.
I feel like there has to be a better way. I mean, yes, okay.
They probably will go to a better way because everyone's complaining, and that's the way magic goes. Is they say the thing that is bad, and then everyone complains about it, and then they're like, okay, like we'll do a less bad thing.
Yeah.
It's going to become like you spend gold and a wild card. I feel like that's the...
I think it'll land in just a wild card. It won't change.
Okay, I'm gonna throw something out as a base concept to work around. I don't necessarily think it's a great idea, maybe, but just in terms of like an alternative. So from Wizards' perspective, they want new players to gravitate towards standard. Right? Because that's where they make their shit. And that's classic. Like, that's how it's always fucking been with paper magic, of course. And veteran players obviously want historic to be, like, fully supported, and they are basically getting fucked over, or at the very least feel like they are.
I think veteran players just want modern... Like, I don't think anyone is married. Like, the thing is, no one's married to historic as a thing.
There's...
Because no one's played it.
I want to say yes and no. Yes, in the sense that I've seen a fair amount of people on Reddit who kind of are coming from the same place I was, where, yeah, historic is going to be standard for, like, the next year or two, but... We want to be a part of it evolving and blah, 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 and all that shit. But Reddit is also a really small user base. Like, you have 100,000 people bitching about something that... What was the statistic? Like, what was their player base? Like, 3 million players? Like, Reddit is a very small portion of that. And how many of those people don't even know any of this stuff is even coming or going on?
Again, I would say most people wouldn't care about the format. They just would want to play their cards.
Yeah. But as a way to as an alternative idea for I guess the people
who are upset. I don't think there's anyone that's passionate, like the number of people that are passionate about historic is going to be fucking minuscule in any way. Like the bigger problem with historic is like how is it going to become a thing that matters?
Yeah. Oh, apparently they do have, like, sets, like, worked out in Arena, like, going back to Shadows over Innistrad.
They don't have Shadows over... They didn't have Shadows over Innistrad finished, but that's...
It's, like, partially done or something?
I think that's, like, where they started.
Okay.
With development, but they weren't building full sets. They were just building... cards
stuff. Yeah
So they have work done going back that far, I guess.
So what would you say if they announced that, like, there was some sort of, I guess for lack of a better term, like a historic player registration thing, like a one-time fee of like $5 or $10 or something, which kind of sounds gross to suggest, but like,
no, that's terrible.
Really? Is that bad?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean,
you're gating it. Gross. I don't want to, like, it's that's no good. I think you're crazy.
I'm just like, in terms of like, compared to double wild card costs.
Well, that's the thing. I don't think there's necessarily something wrong with saying older cards cost a little bit more to disincentivize, to make sure that new players are encouraged to buy the new cards, so that so that someone new's coming in feels like they're like getting rewarded for playing the new stuff. Like, they're not going to see it as like a tax. They're going to see it as, oh, these cards are cheaper. This is the deal.
Yeah. No, I understand what they want for the new player to think, but like.
But
what fucking happens when I just need to craft a mythic?
I just think the problem is their system is their units that they're working with are too fucking big. One mythic wild card is too big to then add on another mythic wild card.
Yes. Yeah.
So that the calibration there is just off. Because, like, saying two wild cards, for commons, that would be whatever. But for rares and mythics, that's fucking brutal.
Yeah.
Well, honestly, it's brutal to an extent. Because, I don't know, I have a lot of cards. If you're a player who's been playing Arena,
yeah,
you probably have the good cards you want. In theory.
In theory,
maybe
yeah.
some weird deck will. I mean, it's the problem with Arena in general is like, if you want to play some offbeat deck, the price is weirdly the super high one compared to just building the good thing that uses the good cards.
Yeah.
Is like a much safer proposition, so people are actually gravitate towards.
Well, and even
more competitive strategies, just because it's easier.
Well,
it's like less expensive in the weird, all rares and mythics are created equal world.
Mm-hmm. Well, even for, you know, I had the little screenshot of like decks that I could build now that I have some wild cards. Mm-hmm. I looked through every single deck that had black in it was running between the main board and sideboard, like at least three copies of Noxious Grasp. And I'm like, mm-hmm. okay, like I'm just going to make four of these because it's running fucking everything now, it looks like. Or, funny enough, Legion's End. I had never even, like, seen it until I started looking at these lists, and I don't think I've seen more than two of it. Or most decks will, like, have two in the main board, or one in main, one inside, or two side, or whatever. And I have two of them already, just coincidentally, so, like, I don't need to make two more of those. But I'm looking for stuff that overlaps, in a way, because if I can spend wild cards on shit that's in multiple decks, that's great. That's, you know, I have that option then.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, so. Legion's End is the interesting thing because, like, that wasn't seen play until Field of the Dead took off. And then Legion's End turned out to be one of the cleaner answers for a board full of tokens.
Mm hmm.
So then it became, like, a staple. So that's, like, the fear of the long-term player who's been getting cards and then wants to play historic going forward, it's like going to be annoying when some weird thing happens in the meta and this card that didn't matter before is suddenly something you desperately want.
I mean,
but, like, how many times is that going to happen,
dude,
compared to like how your collection, I don't know.
That's why I want to drop like a one-time fee, a one-time thing of like $500. Like, I think for
that
my...
seems like a lot, honestly. I don't think you need to do...
No, it's overkill.
I just don't think there are that many cards.
It's 500 is overkill. I think at the... If I was starting from zero, like if I just started the game today, it would be close to 500. But for my collection stats, it's probably closer to one or two. I drop my money on...
I mean, that's the... Yeah, that's the crazy thing about Arena is like you're playing... Someone who's playing it all the time and just spent money on the stuff. Like, I kind of have.
Yeah.
Like, there's always cards I don't have or whatever. There's always, like, the next thing. But that's mostly because I want to build, like, literally every deck.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's
like,
all
if
I
you
feel,
just want to so have it's... one deck, it's which is, like, you know, how I generally live my Magic life previously, is having one good deck.
Well,
if I was playing and that being a burn deck where nothing's expensive, like, it's just so much.
Well, Hank, about that, my one deck was Neo-Niv. How's that been going lately?
I don't know. I mean, Neo-Niv
is going... It's fine. It's still fine, but it's not
bad,
as good as it was. It's rough.
It's real bad in the meta.
Yeah.
I mean, my one deck in this would be Mono Blue, because that...
Mono Blue's been pretty nice.
It's like the cheapest thing.
Yeah.
I would build Mono and Burn was weirdly kind of expensive in certain ways. But I would probably, my two decks would probably be cheap burn and mono blue. Mm-hmm. Like if I were playing Magic Online or whatever.
Yeah. No, the I spent like the throwing money at the game recently. That was like my makeup for missing the M20 pre-order. Yeah.
Yeah.
And the fucking difference that makes, honestly. Like, just opening those packs and it's like instantaneously four mythic rare cards, like, I think it was, what I say, like 10 or 11 rares and then commons and uncommons, along with the shit that you actually open. Like, it's kind of ridiculous how much that puts you ahead. And it's not...
Yeah, it's not nice. Bad. You get to play Magic with cards.
Yeah. And it's not, like... It's
fun.
I still remember when... And this is, like, the thing that I point to. Or, like, if I'm explaining to somebody just very quickly what it feels like. You know, there was this card I really liked. It was really cool. It was something called Hydroid Crisis. And it was great. Loved playing with it. Looked up the price in paper one day. 38 per card is what it, like, peaked at. And that's ridiculous. Yeah. I just crafted four of them immediately. And it was said and done.
Because that was, like, the card for that set. And it ate all the value of a box. So, like, if you wanted to build anything else in that set, or buy any other card, like a single, not that expensive. That one card was, like, the whole... That was your box, basically.
Mm-hmm. No, like, overall, I'm still... Yeah. I'm still very happy with Arena and, like, the decisions that they've generally been making. Like, there's little shit here and there, but...
I mean, yeah, no. My big thing is, though, just generally about what I want from Historic.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I want Historic to replace Modern, because Modern is too expensive. And it's, like, it's dumb how expensive Modern is. Like, they unbanned Stoneforge Mystic... And Stoneforge Mystic and all those equipment are ridiculous.
Like, yeah, right all now. The swords and all that shit.
It's just all terrible.
Yep. No, like, it's...
Like, they it's unbanning gross. That stuff without reprinting it. Like, at least they unbanned Jace, they reprinted him.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's still fucking... It's not a good situation. That guard's still $100, but...
I'm still in a weird spot about that. I think even more so than the two wild card thing. Like, in terms of bringing like staples or shit like Brainstorm into Arena, and it's like the worst because I read something like when we talked a bit about it in chat. And, like, you made some good points, and then, like, other people on Reddit have said stuff that's similar and, like, good points about why it's cool that these cards are coming in and how they'll be fun for the format and all that shit. And I'm like, I agree with that. I can see that. And then someone else comes in and they're like, yo, this is really fucking dumb, and I just kind of want to play with Historic cards instead of, like, staples from formats that have already been solved or whatever shit that they happen to be saying. And I'm like, I agree with that. Like, It's the worst. I don't know how I feel about it.
I mean, my big thing is, like, I'm really bored with Standard.
Yep.
No, I've that's played fair. With these cards a lot, and just letting this formatting, like, they have to get more cards into this thing, into this pool.
Yeah.
Like, if it's going to be a
okay, fun, like, hear me out, though.
A fun thing. I just need more cards. Fucking... Like, I would be fine if they bring in, you know, you just dump Almanket and Kaladesh, theoretically, but, like, even with building... With the one wild card thing, that's a fucking lot.
Mm-hmm.
And if they were, like, business-wise, if they were backfilling sets, I would probably just buy like pre-orders for backfill sets and be less interested in standard.
Yeah.
Like, honestly, like if they were doing, if they were actually backfilling correctly and well, like it actually would kill my interest in standard. Mm-hmm. I would be less interested if I could just focus on historic. So I get where they're coming from. Also, you know, I just like powerful artifacts, so I just want Kaladesh in that game. I just want to do the dumb broken artifact thing. Ugh. Personally.
Man.
I don't know
how. I mean, I would be. Like, I want them to put vintage in this game personally.
I mean,
that would be great. Just put Power like 9 into historic. There we go. They're your cards. They're your backfilling. Ancestral Recall. Boom.
Christ. That's disgusting. Could you imagine that as like a one-off event, though? Like just randomly it's like pre-con vintage decks or some shit.
Yeah, man. Do Vintage Cube. Fucking, it's great.
There are people who have been like,
they do that on MTGO. Probably. They do Phantom draft stuff. Cubes are very popular. It's like the most, it's like the thing that actually keeps MTGO going are cubes.
Someone said that they were upset enough with how they're handling historic that they were going to stop playing Arena, stop playing Paper, build their cube, and then like that's the only Magic they would do.
A, who are they playing with? And B, that's fine. Like, live your life. If you're if you have a group to play the cube you want to play all the time with, that sounds fine. But I mean, I don't know. At some point that gets old. Like part of the fun of Magic is like all the different ways you can play it.
Mm-hmm.
Also, that doesn't sound like Commander to me. So I don't know what to do. This doesn't sound like multiplayer free-for-all Magic, which is actually my favorite form of Magic, so.
Yeah. No, that's like the one thing I wish. With Brawl, I wish we were getting multiplayer.
That's the tragedy, is that MTGO has 4-player, but Arena won't.
That's why we got tabletop.
Yeah. But imagine if you could. Oh, yeah, I mean, you can't even do that on MTGO, but imagine if you could just do multiplayer queues, Ben.
Imagine if we could just do what?
Multiplayer queues. You just jump into a queue and you're playing a free-for-all 4-player game.
Oh, that'd be pretty good. It'd actually
It's also a nightmare. Because if you're just playing against, like, competitive multiplayer decks all the time.
Yeah, I guess. But, like, how perfect would that be on Arena, though? You just turn off the fucking emoticons or whatever and the phrases. Mm-hmm. You just enjoy life.
Yeah.
Because, honestly, talking to people is the worst part of Magic. Easily.
Yeah, look, I've played a little bit of Commander on MTGO. It's fun. It's fine. It's not, you know, hanging out with your friends and playing a board game or whatever, but, you know, it's still interesting play experience.
Hmm.
It's kind of different, but it's still good.
Not the same as playing an 8-man game of EDH in a Taco Bell on a Tuesday at 2 a.m., but it's something.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm excited. It feels good to be excited about Magic again. Like, in a way that's not just Commander. Because, as you said, like, part of the fun of Magic is how many different ways you can play it. And for a long time, it was like, well, I have Commander, and I have these decks that I never play. And then I draft, and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's fun. Like, Arena makes Magic something you can just play.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty great because, well, it's also good because they actually hired a team to balance standards, so standards been way better than it was previously.
Yeah,
from what I can tell.
I don't know. And when did that come on? Did that start with? Jesus, what would that have been? It
started with Dominaria.
What?
Technically, Dominaria is their first play design set.
I forget, and it's terrible that I've forgotten this. Did Dominaria come before or after Ixalan? It was after, right?
After, right. Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So some of the people that became the play design team helped on Ixalan, but the play design team itself wasn't fully formed.
Yeah.
And developing the set from start to finish till Dominaria.
Mm-hmm. It's like, I don't know, Ixalan like, felt fine.
So like, right. this standard with all the sets in it was the first standard with all the cards in it that play design had fully developed. Like,
yeah.
When we were in the earlier parts of the beta and Kaladesh and Amonkhet blocks were in this, like, they hadn't completely sculpted that format, and that was...
Mm-hmm.
They just made some of the sets. Or whatever.
No, it's... It
hadn't all been as thought out.
It's felt very Ixalan, nice.
Ixalan had the issue of just them tapping down and being less complicated and ending up kind of boring because of Kaladesh was too crazy.
Yeah.
Which is, like, really how Magic used to work is they would just, like, cycle around of, like, oh, so it's getting crazier and crazier. Up, fucking went too far. Everything's broken. And then a hard crash and, like, where they bring it back to basics and, like, oh, the power level gets scaled way down. And then people who are franchise players are like, fuck this. Why are these cards all bad?
Yeah. No, and, like, I remember
only limited players are, like, happy with it.
Yeah.
Or whatever.
No, drafting for Ixalan was fucking great. Swing out, don't block unless you absolutely fucking have to, and then just swing out again. Keep doing it.
Yeah. Play your 2/2 that gives all your things +1/+1. No, regardless of what color you're in.
Yeah. There was some good
and
then times.
Fucking War of the Spark comes, and it's like, okay. Oh no, I forgot he has a Narset. Oh no,
dude.
I forgot he has a.
Yeah,
I forgot what fucking Tamiyo's static ability is because that card already seems too good with just its activated abilities. Fucking... But also, Thought Erasure does nothing against them now. Whoops.
Man. The amount of shit that people just forget or, like... I love an arena that you can watch people hover over things. Like,
yes.
They look at their own thing. They look at the thing you just played.
Yeah. Like, the most wrong take I've ever heard about arena was people early on who are like, I don't think they should show you what your opponent's hovering. I don't like that. I'm like, you're super wrong. It's so good.
The
like when you see them hovering your card because they are reading it because they made a mistake.
I think ultimately I like the hovering, but I understand like it feels bad if you're like
of another
shit,
person.
I want to see without, what this like, card actually, does without having to like leave the game,
seeing them.
But I don't want to alert them potentially
like
to what
to
I'm thinking of, and then they, you know, they win or do whatever stupid thing. Which
Better
is like,
there.
You know, just I look it up you. On your phone or something, I guess. But no, it's absolutely worth it when you play something dumb and they don't know what happened and you get to watch them be confused. Ale of Summer has been my culprit for that lately.
Mm.
Like, I guess people haven't encountered it quite enough. Or they just don't expect it out of a mono green deck for some reason.
Mm-hmm. It's pretty good. Pretty good. My favorite is still Collision Colossus for getting people.
Collision Colossus is so good. It's so good.
Nobody plays around it.
Yeah. No, you weren't fucking around when you said that. Like, nobody knew what was going on.
Yeah. They just don't get it. They don't put it together.
I think.
Or if they do, they don't know what else to do other than just block.
Yeah. Even with the, what is it, 6 damage to target flying creature?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, even that, like, sometimes, I remember some dude, I had been sitting on, like, 3 of them for the entire game, just weren't useful.
Mm-hmm.
The dude finally popped down a Nicol Bolas Ravager.
Mm-hmm.
I destroyed it. He popped down, I think, a different dragon of some sort. I destroyed it. And then he popped out, like, he was looking for a while and, like, looked in the graveyard and shit the whole 9 yards. Popped down another Ravager. Like, this guy couldn't possibly have 3 of this terrible card, right? Wrong, bitch.
That card's then, great.
Then the concede happened. Oh, it's really good.
It's pretty good. It's pretty great.
Do you still run it mono red? Like, did it make it into the, I guess the new version? I don't know what versions of mono red you have or version.
Well, I finally crafted Goblin Chain Whirlers, so I could actually build. Like, as part of one of the reasons I built that first version is like, I don't want to spend rare wild cards.
Yeah.
Those things are valuable. So I built a version that didn't use most of the rares. But now I have all of them. So actually I just have 2. I do have 2 versions. I have the version that the version that has less rares and still runs it. And then I have just, I built like the version that people play.
Yeah.
Just because I wanted to actually play with it. And I don't run it in that one. So I could.
I had like 99%. I could
find a.
What's the one that people run mainly right now? I have the, what is it? Cavalclave. A 1/1.
What?
The thing where you swing out with 1/1s. That strategy. Is that the go-to mono red right now, or is it still more of like a burn deck?
I think the burn deck is still the go-to. Okay. I think they they do play Chandra Acolyte of Flame, but
yeah, makes sense.
Or not? Like some of them do, some of them don't. I don't know.
Yeah,
but clearly the hottest tech is that sweet, sweet unbanning of Rampaging Ferocidon.
Hell yeah, dude.
The hottest in tech.
Someone was talking about how that would...
That I haven't built yet. Oh, no, I did. But, like, it's legal in MTGO, but not legal in Arena yet, for whatever reason.
So...
Like, they unbanned it, but it wasn't actually unbanned yet. Or something. At least last time I was playing Red.
I mean... I have enough to build Jund Dinos. And I'm very tempted.
That deck seems fun.
It does. I love dinos. It
seems like one that's going away and like...
Going away or going historic?
No, that's fair.
Yeah. And if I craft them now, I won't be able to afford it in about a month.
Well, yeah. Well, the cards I don't have for it, are a lot of them are the new cards. So... Mm. I think
I'm missing like everything from it. I like started up again part of the way through Dominaria, so Ixalan Block is where I'm missing most of my shit. Ixalan and Dominaria are rough for me.
Ugh, fucking deck limit. I hate it.
Yeah, they need to fix that with Historic and Brawl coming. They need to fix that shit. Give us folders and let us have like 1,000 decks per folder. Something nice and simple.
Nope, not what I wanted to do. Alright, let's see how many cards from Gen Dinos I'm missing. What are the key cards? I'm missing Commune with the Dinosaurs.
What the fuck?
Commons, so I should probably have that.
Why do you not have it?
I don't have any of them. I don't know. Because I haven't built a dino deck. Oh, I'm missing 3 Ripjaw Raptors. I'm missing 3 Regisaur Alphas. And this stupid deck thing can't understand that I have different Galtas.
Mm.
I technically have 5 Galtas. Because I have 3 of the one from the event with the different art. And then 2
right. regular ones. I don't... Do you remember what event that was?
No.
Because I know it exists, like, I remember it vaguely, but I don't have the, I never got the art. Whatever it was, I was frustrated enough with it that I said, fuck it, and I just didn't bother.
It was before they did the thing where, it was the thing where you would get kicked out if you had a certain number of losses. You had to have a certain win rate, rather than the way they do it now, where you just have to win a certain number.
Hmm.
So that's why I didn't get all 4.
Yeah.
Also partly because, like, most... Basically every deck that's playing Galta is only playing 3.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's not actually a card people play 4 of. So 3 was fine.
Yeah, I'm just missing... I'm missing 3 Marauding Raptors, 1 Rotting Regisaur, 4 Ripjaws, and 3 Regisaur Alphas.
The thing I need to spend wild cards on before historic changes are there's a couple of Ixalan lands I don't have 4 of, I think.
There's a lot I don't have 4 of.
Yeah. I was being... I mean, that's what I was spending my wild cards on, was getting lands for a while.
Are you... How many do you have, do you know?
Of the... Let's look. Rare... Let's look at rare lands. And take Galta out of the search.
Where are my Galta?
It's gonna be easier. It's gonna be easier to go over the ones I'm missing. I'm missing 2 Dragon Skull Summits. I'm missing 3 Sun Petal Groves.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Yeah,
that's what I'm missing. Yeah, I have 4 of everything else, except I don't have 4 of all the scry lands, which are going to be important as soon as rotation happens.
Man, I'm debating if I want to drop... I have 11 rares, and I'm like half tempted to just drop them on that. Like, either a deck or doing that.
Yeah, that's fair.
Like, do I want something I can actually play with? Probably
you want something you can actually play with.
Yeah. And I mean, like, for that deck, I would probably do the lands with it.
Yeah, yeah.
In case I wanted to just do historic or something.
Mm-hmm.
Like vampires.
Yeah.
Man, the Kethys combo deck, though. I just need fucking everything. Like, it's absurd.
Yeah, that one I wouldn't have been nearly as close if I hadn't built, like, the combo deck that is similar, the Teshar combo deck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so like that's where I got my 2 Urza's Ruinous Blasts and my Mox Ambers for that deck. It's also like the times I feel the most frustrated about not having cards have been like I had these in the beta before the wipe.
Oh yeah,
and then I never built them because it's like I played that I don't need to play that again, right? I don't need to rebuild. I can buy other stuff and build different decks or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, I have like none of the vampire stuff because the vampires was the first deck I built in the beta.
Yeah.
But Mox Ambers was like tragic because it was part of my actual favorite deck. but I have them. I spent all those mythics on that bad card. That's like super essential for certain broken combos.
Yeah. Well, that's what people have said too. Like, that card is either junk or broken as fuck.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't even know. Like,
yeah, that Kethis deck is weird. Like, the first couple times I played it, I definitely lost just because I didn't actually understand how it worked.
Mm-hmm.
But I also didn't, like, I also did the dumb thing of just building the deck and not reading about how the combo actually worked.
Oh, yeah, no, absolutely.
Because it's reading, it's one of those combos that like, technically, you're not guaranteed to win or, like, keep resolving, but...
Yeah, it's not infinite or whatever. It's not a loop, necessarily.
Yeah.
Or not an automatic loop.
Well, like... Because you have to keep activating Kethis's ability to cast stuff from your graveyard by exiling legendary things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you have to keep applying that. It's not like, oh, for the turn, you can cast a historic cards from your graveyard. Like, a legendary stuff from your graveyard. It's, you activate it, exile two things, and then everything that's currently in your graveyard. So you're like, your loop is, you do that, then you play all your Mox Ambers for mana, and that triggers your Diligent Excavator or whatever to mill yourself so that you have more food for your Kethis to then do it again and get your Mox Ambers back, and then maybe, like, you're either, like, then off that you're, like, looping Fibblethips, or you're looping Teferis, or you're looping Ashiok. Like,
yeah.
It could be, like, any one of these things.
Mm-hmm.
Or you're like Ashioking, like the craziest. Ashiok is such a nuts card because
I love Ashiok.
You
so
can
much.
Target either player for the mill, but it always exiles your opponent's graveyard.
Yep, it's great.
You're like, I mill myself, and then your library gets exiled. What? The first time I realized that was how that worked, I was like, oh.
Yeah, no, it's ridiculous.
What?
Man.
All I'm saying, though, is probably build Narsets. Because that card is super broken in old formats. So the better the card pool is, the better that card is, generally.
Like, Parter of Veils?
Yeah.
Narset.
Yeah.
Uncommon? There's only uncommon. Yep. Yeah, I got that.
Yep. Yeah. That's a good one. It's just funny, like, how many good blue 3-mana planeswalkers there were in Forth Spark. Between that, like, the Saheeli one doesn't see play just because, not because it's bad, it's just there are too many other good ones.
Mm-hmm.
Between Teferi and Narset, and to a lesser extent Ashiok. But really, Teferi and Narset are like the two.
Yeah. Oh, Teferi is... Well, that's what people have been saying for Brawl. Because Brawl rules, you can use a Planeswalker as your commander. And everyone's like, so excited for all the Teferi decks. Gonna be great.
I don't think Teferi will be the...
He'll be that great. And if he is, people will just react by shitting on him.
Well, the problem is, like, the answer to the Teferi... The best answer to a Teferi control deck in this card pool is Teferi Time Reveler.
Yeah.
It's your own Teferi. Like, that was... It was the secret to the Niv-Mizzet deck is, like, I need to be control. Oh, I'll play Teferi. Done.
Hell yeah.
GG. Yeah. It's funny how, like, that deck was so much more effective when I had things I was... I know, it's maybe I just haven't rebuilt it correctly. Because the reason it worked, it was so hard targeting two specific styles. It was targeting burn, and like, I have to beat burn. I have to be able to beat burn, and I have to be able to beat hard control.
Yes.
Yeah. No, I remember that.
And like, I don't have... It's not like... my deck isn't built for like, I have to be able to beat Field of the Dead... I have to be able to beat Grixis control. I have to be able to beat Kethys combo. Although I haven't even really seen that many other people playing Kethys combo.
I haven't encountered it yet.
Yeah. It's pretty gross.
Yeah. Man.
It's just like... You're kind of just like at a point, it's just one of those decks where earlier than a normal deck, you're like, oh, I just win. The deck it reminds me of is like Nexus of Fate.
Yeah.
Where you're just like, oh, I've just reached this point, I just win. I'm just casting Nexus of Fates now. You let me get to 7 mana with a Wilderness Reclamation, the game's over.
Mm-hmm.
Or whatever.
Anyway.
Like, I've resolved a Kethys. I've milled... I have stuff in my graveyard.
It's here we go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the best part is people recognize what... People who... You can tell the difference between people who know what the combo is and people who don't.
Mm-hmm.
People that sit there and make you do all the stuff and people who just instantly can see. It's like... Have you seen this loop before? Yes, no. All right. But yeah, I think that's the podcast. We've talked for as long as the movie
is. Which, you know, we knew the risks.
I mean, I specifically said it would probably go longer if we started.
I mean, absolutely could.
So you can email us at saltcirclepodcast@gmail.com. Find us on Twitter at Salt Circle Podcast. We're on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Salt Circle Podcast. And you can find me on Twitter at Comic Panels. And our episodes are hosted at anchor.fm/Salt Circle.
Yeah, I'm on Twitter at @B_LP.
Neat.
Yeah. Can't wait for next week's Magic episode.
No.
God help us.
Next week will not be a Magic episode. We'll do something else next week.
You say that.
It's a mystery.
You say that. It's yeah, I still don't know what movie we're watching. At all.
Maybe I'll change it and you'll never know.
Well, no, if the time is different. If you change it to one with the exact same time.
Now I just find a movie with the same time.
It was an hour and 22 minutes.
Project.